verses 10 to 16. Here is, I God's judgment upon Miriam, v. 10 The cloud departed from off that part of the tabernacle, in token of God's displeasure, and presently Miriam became leprous. When God goes, evil comes, expect no good when God departs. The leprosy was a disease often inflicted by the immediate hand of God as the punishment of some particular sin, as on Gehazi for lying, on Uzziah for invading the priest's office, and here on Miriam for scolding and making mischief among relations. The plague of the leprosy, it is likely, appeared in her face, so that it appeared to all that saw her that she was struck with it, with the worst of it, she was leprous as snow, not only so white, but so soft, the solid flesh losing its consistency, as that which putrefies does. Her foul tongue, says Bishop Hall, is justly punished with a foul face, and her folly in pretending to be a rival with Moses is made manifest to all men, for everyone sees his face to be glorious, and hers to be leprous. While Moses needs a veil to hide his glory, Miriam needs one to hide her shame. Note, those distempers which anyway deform us ought to be construed as a rebuke to our pride, and improved for the cure of it, and under such humbling providences we ought to be very humble. It is a sign that the heart is hard indeed if the flesh be mortified, and yet the lusts of the flesh remain unmortified. It should seem that this plague upon Miriam was designed for an exposition of the law concerning the leprosy, Leviticus 13, for it is referred to upon the rehearsal of that law, do. 24:8-9. Miriam was struck with a leprosy, but not Aaron, because she was first in the transgression, and God would put a difference between those that mislead and those that are misled. Aaron's office, though it saved him not from God's displeasure, yet helped to secure him from this token of his displeasure, which would not only have suspended him for the present from officiating, when, there being no priests but himself and his two sons, he could ill be spared, but it would have rendered him and his office mean, and would have been a lasting blot upon his family. Aaron as priest was to be the judge of the leprosy, and his performing that part of his office upon this occasion, when he looked upon Miriam, and behold she was leprous, was a sufficient mortification to him. He was struck through her side, and could not pronounce her leprous without blushing and trembling, knowing himself to be equally obnoxious. This judgment upon Miriam is improvable by us as a warning to take heed of putting any affront upon our Lord Jesus. If she was thus chastised for speaking against Moses, what will become of those that sin against Christ? Aaron's submission hereupon, v. 11, 12, he humbles himself to Moses, confesses his fault, and begs pardon. He that but just now joined with his sister in speaking against Moses is here forced for himself and his sister to make a penitent address to him, and in the highest degree to magnify him, as if he had the power of God to forgive and heal, whom he had so lately vilified. Note, those that trample upon the saints and servants of God will one day be glad to make court to them, at furthest, in the other world, as the foolish virgins to the wise for a little oil, and the rich man to Lazarus for a little water, and perhaps in this world, as Job's friend to him for his prayers, and here Aaron to Moses. Revelation 3:9. In his submission, he confesses his own and his sister's sin, v. 11. He speaks respectfully to Moses, of whom he had spoken slightly, calls him his Lord, and now turns the reproach upon himself, speaks as one ashamed of what he had said, we have sinned, we have done foolishly. Those sin, and do foolishly, who revile and speak evil of any, especially of good people or of those in authority. Repentance is the unsaying of that which we have said amiss, and it had better be unsaid than that we be undone by it. He begs Moses's pardon, lay not this sin upon us. Aaron was to bring his gift to the altar, but, knowing that his brother had something against him, he of all men was concerned to reconcile himself to his brother, that he might be qualified to offer his gift. Some think that this speedy submission which God saw him ready to make was that which prevented his being struck with a leprosy as his sister was. 3. He recommends the deplorable condition of his sister to Moses's compassionate consideration, v. 12 Let her not be as one dead, that is, let her not continue so separated from conversation, defiling all she touches, and even to putrefy above ground as one dead. He eloquently describes the misery of her case, to move his pity. The intercession made for Miriam, v. 13. He cried unto the Lord with a loud voice, because the cloud, the symbol of his presence, was removed and stood at some distance, and to express his fervency in this request, heal her now, O Lord, I beseech thee. By this he made it to appear that he did heartily forgive her the injury she had won him, that he had not accused her to God, nor called for justice against her, so far from this that, when God in tenderness to his honor had chastised her insolence, he was the first that moved for reversing the judgment. By this example we are taught to pray for those that despitefully use us, and not to take pleasure in the most righteous punishment inflicted either by God or man on those that have been injurious to us. Jeroboam's withered hand was restored at the special instance and request of the prophet against whom it had been stretched out, 1 Kings 13:6. So Miriam here was healed by the prayer of Moses, whom she had abused, and Abimelech by the prayer of Abraham, General 20:17. Moses might have stood off, and have said, she is served well enough, let her govern her tongue better next time, but, not content with being able to say that he had not prayed for the inflicting of the judgment, he prays earnestly for the removal of it. This pattern of Moses, and that of our Savior, Father, forgive them, we must study to conform to. The accommodating of this matter so as that mercy and justice might meet together. 1. Mercy takes place so far as that Miriam shall be healed, Moses forgives her, and God will. See 2 Kings 2:10. But, 2. Justice takes place so far as that Miriam shall be humbled, v. 14. Let her be shut out from the camp 7 days, that she herself might be made more sensible of her fault and penitent for it, and that her punishment might be the more public, and all Israel might take notice of it and take warning by it not to mutiny. If Miriam the prophetess be put under such marks of humiliation for one hasty word spoken against Moses, what may we expect for our murmurings? If this be done in a green tree, what shall be done in the dry? See how people debase and diminish themselves by sin, stain their glory, and lay their honor in the dust. When Miriam praised God, we find her at the head of the congregation and one of the brightest ornaments of it, Ex. 15:20. Now that she quarreled with God we find her expelled as the filth and offscouring of it. A reason is given for her being put out of the camp for 7 days, because thus she ought to accept of the punishment of her iniquity. If her father, her earthly father, had but spit in her face, and so signified his displeasure against her, would she not be so troubled and concerned at it, and so sorry that she had deserved it, as to shut herself up for some time in her room, and not come into his presence, or show her face in the family, being ashamed of her own folly and unhappiness? If such reverence as this be owing to the fathers of our flesh, when they correct us, much more ought we to humble ourselves under the mighty hand of the Father of spirits, Hebrews 12:9. Note, when we are under the tokens of God's displeasure for sin, it becomes us to take shame to ourselves, and to lie down in that shame, owning that to us belongs confusion of face. If by our own fault and folly we expose ourselves to the reproach and contempt of men, the just censures of the church, or the rebukes of the divine providence, we must confess that our Father justly spits in our face, and be ashamed. V. The hindrance that this gave to the people's progress, the people journeyed not till Miriam was brought in again, v. 15. God did not remove the cloud, and therefore they did not remove their camp. This was intended, 1. As a rebuke to the people, who were conscious to themselves of having sinned after the similitude of Miriam's transgression, in speaking against Moses, thus far therefore they shall share in her punishment, that it shall retard their march forward towards Canaan. Many things oppose us, but nothing hinders us in the way to heaven as sin does. 2. As a mark of respect to Miriam. If the camp had removed during the days of her suspension, her trouble and shame had been the greater, therefore, in compassion to her, they shall stay till her excommunication be taken off, and she taken in again, it is probable with the usual ceremonies of the cleansing of lepers. Note, those that are under censure and rebuke for sin ought to be treated with a great deal of tenderness, and not be overloaded, no, not with the shame they have deserved, not counted as enemies, 2 Thessalonians 3:15, but forgiven and comforted, 2 Cor 2:7. Sinners must be cast out with grief, and penitents taken in with joy. When Miriam was absolved and readmitted, the people went forward into the wilderness of Paran, which joined up to the south border of Canaan, and thither their next remove would have been if they had not put a bar in their own way.